Yeah, so today's scripture is from Genesis 37, verse 2 to 11. This is the account of Jacob's family line. Joseph, a young man of 17, was tending the flocks with his brothers, the son of Bilhah and the sons of Zilpah, his father's wives, and he brought their father a bad report about them. Now Israel loved Joseph more than any of his other sons, because he had been born to him in his old age, and he made an ornate robe for him. When his brothers saw that their father loved him more than any of them, they hated him and could not speak a kind word to him. Joseph had a dream, and when he told it to his brothers, they hated him all the more. He said to them, "Listen to this dream I had. We were binding sheaves of grain out in the field, when suddenly my sheaf rose and stood upright, while your sheaves gathered around mine and bowed down to it." His brothers said to him, "Do you intend to reign over us? Will you actually rule us?" And they hated him all the more because of his dream and what he had said. Then he had another dream, and he told to his brothers, "Listen," he said, "I had another dream, and this time the sun and moon and 11 stars were bowing down to me." When he told his father as well as his brothers, his father rebuked him and said, "What is this dream you had? Will your mother and I and your brothers actually come and bow down to the ground before you?" His brothers were jealous of him, but his fathers kept the matter in mind. This is the word of the Lord.
Howdy. Hey. Good morning, folks. How are y'all doing? Huh? Good morning, folks. How are y'all doing? It's good to see you in church on a Sunday morning. We have a really full house today, so it's good to have all y'all back. Folks, you know, we're of course concluding our series today. I do have a lot of ground to cover, but first off, you know, I just want to give again another shout out and thanks and appreciation to our fundraising committee. They've been working behind the scenes to organize a whole bunch of stuff. And so over the next few weeks, I will be giving doing little golf claps, okay? Yeah, all right. Okay, so. Yes, so there will be a bunch of good stuff happening over the next few weeks. I will be giving all of y'all an update on our fundraising efforts, where we're at in terms of the pledge amount, how much money is actually coming in. We will also be sharing different efforts and initiatives from members of the community. There are a bunch of people that are, you know, using their own skills and talents and gifts to, you know, raise funds for the church, and something that we really deeply appreciate and want to shine the spotlight on. And so, you know, I just want to say right from the get-go, this is, of course, you know, an endeavor that we are all taking on together as a faith community. We are dreaming of the future of our church together. And as your pastor would say this, that success to me with regards to the fundraising campaign is not that we would hit the figure or the amount, even though that is really important. But success to me looks less like 100% amount, but more of 100% participation. And so I want to implore you, if you have not received a pledge card or received a pledge card last week, to take the card. There's a bunch of information on there, and prayerfully consider giving to our church, giving to not just our church here and now, but the vision of our church for the future. And so I want to encourage you to prayerfully consider. Folks, 100% participation, that's what we're going after, right? And so whether you have little or plenty, please consider faithfully giving to our community. Amen? Very muted response. And so I would think that you're just deeply stewing on it by faith. Because if this is the where we're starting, it's not going to go in a very good direction. Before that, I have to say to you today. Next thing with core groups, this is a new thing, a new initiative, and I like to think of it as the next evolution of the discipleship, of our roadmap discipleship here in our church. If you recall, some 5-6 years ago, we really fought hard to have all of you participate in life groups. Our church then was about maybe 30% participation in life groups, and I really thought a lot about community and really sowed the vision vision that life groups, you know, this act of coming together as a smaller community is essential, is crucial to our discipleship. And we're presenting core groups to you today, you know, groups of three where you go through, you know, those rhythms of confession, others reading this sermon as something crucial to your discipleship as well. And following that, you know, we're hoping sometime end of next year, middle of next year, to talk about mentorship as well. And so the groups are getting smaller and smaller and smaller. And so want to encourage you to participate in that. I think it's going to be really life-giving. I do have an idea that I shared at the staff team, but it was vetoed. I talked about how, you know, we can each give you like a piece of colored string, unique colors, and then you form your group of three, and then you can form a little friendship band, and then you like wear it because it's a cord, three strands, and a friendship band. And then if you're very extroverted, you have like multiple bands. And then they said no. The travesty of turning down such a brilliant idea. And so by a round of applause, how many of you want that? Okay. So the idea is not going to happen by that lackluster response. But folks, are you ready for God's word this morning? We are closing out the series. Excited to be speaking to you this morning. Folks, you know, very recently I caught up with a friend, and I've not seen that friend for, you know, some 2.5 to 3 years. I've not seen him, you know, since COVID. And I think life or time can be divided to like before COVID and after disease, you know, BC and AD, that's the new way we split time. And I've not seen him for a really, really long time. And so when I saw him, he looked really different. He looked like he aged a lot. And he looked at me and he said, you seem like you've aged a lot. And the reason why I'm telling you he aged a lot is because he made the comment about me aging a lot. And so I needed to say, yeah, you too. He's aged a lot, you know. He has like little kind of strands of white hair now, and COVID wasn't really pretty for him, you know. He's a pastor, like me. And we were just, you know, catching up, talking about, you know, just reflecting and debriefing over the last 2.5 years, this season we've gone through as pastors, the unique struggles, the battles that we've fought, and the stuff we've seen God do, and some of the things that we're currently working through. And we were just talking about some of the pains that we've felt in the context of our faith community, some of the disappointments we've experienced as pastors in our congregation, but also with looking up to certain faith leaders, certain teachers, pastors that we really looked up to that had been a big influence to our ministries, who had failed, you know, who had fallen off, you know, and are no longer following Jesus or had some kind of moral failure at some point in the ministry. And I'm just talking through all these things. And he looked at me, you know, and at a point in time, you know, it got a bit emotional. And he said, there's just this line that really that just summed up the entire conversation. And he said this to me. He said, Andre, it's really hard to hope. It's really hard to hope. And this was coming off of the back of, you know, hoping and hoping and hoping again all through this 2.5 years and experiencing disappointment, the disappointment after disappointment, and not, you know, feeling like, you know, hope is such a realistic thing anymore to do, or hope is such a smart thing to do anymore. If disappointment is just going to come again and again, why should I hope to begin with? Now, has there ever been a moment in your life where you struggled to hope? Where hope seems like a far off and difficult thing to do? Maybe it's not just in reference to the last 2.5 years, but the entire trajectory, the entire span of your life. Has there ever been a moment in your life where you found it difficult to hope? Could be on the other side of a prolonged bout of illness, could be the loss of a job, loved one, a desire for reconciliation with someone and it not seeming to go in the right direction, placing your hope in something or someone and being let down. Remember when we were young boys, Axel and I were in Christine's life group, and we often talked about how, hey, if Christine like backslide and no longer follow Jesus, will we still have faith in Jesus? And so the good thing is that Christine hasn't backslidden or has not backslidden, and so the mystery is still out there whether our faith will remain intact. Placing your hope in someone. Please don't, because I'm not sure, you know. Right, Axel? Yeah. Putting your hope in someone and being let down, struggling to hope. You know, one of my favorite stories in the Bible is found in Luke chapter 24, and it's the story of the two on the road to Emmaus. And it's a biblical account of these two dazed and distraught disciples who had just experienced the most traumatic weekend of their lives, right? They were, in some sense, on a roller coaster of emotion, of grief, sadness, of fear, of disappointment. On Friday, these disciples, along with many in the world, witnessed the painful, humiliating, and violent death of their beloved teacher, friend, and Messiah. And at night, they sat through, you know, despair, and now they're on the other side of it, you know, dazed and distraught. And now the story was telling tells us in Luke 24 that these two were leaving the city. They were leaving the city. They were leaving, presumably, the community of disciples that they had lived with for a period of time. They were leaving, this city where God's call was first given there. They were leaving this city where they had, you know, walked with Jesus and ministered with Jesus. They were leaving this city and presumably heading home, walking away from the call of Jesus. And what sums up really all these painful emotions of fear, the insecurity, the disappointment, the despair, the disillusionment is this short phrase that we read in verse 21 of this story. But we had hoped. But we had hoped. And I wonder if this phrase kind of captures the sentiments over the last 2.5 years for you personally or for someone else that you know. But we had hoped. But we had hoped. Weary and disillusioned from living under Roman rule, these two had hope that Jesus would come and liberate them from the Roman rule, that he would come and liberate them from this oppressive regime where some historians would say that no Jews were paying upwards of 80-90% in taxes in that day. Right, complain about taxes. They were paying 80-90% of taxes, and they were, in some sense, living as slaves in their own land. And they had this earnest longing and expectation that Jesus would come and liberate them. And now their hopes had been dashed. Jesus is dead. And now in this story, you read that they were walking away from the life they had once lived. A sense of despair in their soul, an abandonment of calling, an abandonment of a life in pursuit of Jesus. I don't know whether this hits home close to you, whether personally I've seen people over the last 2.5 years having their hopes dashed, a despair, disillusionment entering their soul, followed swiftly by an abandonment for life in pursuit of Jesus. I have many personal friends, who have walked away from Jesus because their hopes had been dashed. Now, shifting gears really sharply. This past week, Grammy Award-winning rapper and producer Coolio died. He died of a suspected heart attack at age 59. And Coolio wrote probably one of the most anthemic songs of the 90s, the song Gangsta Paradise. I told you, shifting gears sharply. Now, the song describes this prototypical life of a gangster. I say gangsta because it ends with an A. And it's amidst this lure of street gangs, right, striving for violence with the threat of death always hanging around them and yet getting nothing in return. And the most recognizable lyric in the song is in the first verse, and it reads this way. As I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I take a look at my life and realize there's nothing left. Even my mama thought, okay. Right, so many of us know this song, yeah? And of course, we recognize the first line, don't we? First line is from Psalm 23, as I walk through the valley of the shadow of death. But instead of going on, you know, and with, you know, whatever is a biblical text, Coolio expresses this feeling of loss, of confusion, of regret, of a life mislived. I take a look at my life and realize there's nothing left. Imagine coming to a point in your life and realizing that you did not or you had not pursued the life that you should have. William Irvine, in his book, Guide to the Good Life, The Ancient Art of Stoic Joy, talks about a life that drifts with culture and lacks holy vision as a kind of misliving. He talks about it this way. There is a danger that you will mislive. Despite all your activity, despite all the pleasant diversions you might have enjoyed while alive, you will end up living a bad life. There is, in other words, a danger that when you are on your deathbed, you will look back and realize that you wasted your one chance at living. Instead of spending your life pursuing something genuinely valuable, you squandered it because you allowed yourself to be distracted by the various baubles life has to offer. Misliving. I'm sure all of you don't want to end up at the end of your life with these feelings of regret, of misliving, of being successful, excellent, and proficient at utterly useless things. When my brother and I were younger, we were really into this game called Maple Story. And we had shifts, bro. We had shifts. My brother would game at night, I would game in the day, and we got our warrior up to a level 120. Now, Coco, maybe you can give some insight. With your last employer, did this talk about having a level 120 warrior ever come up? Like, you have a level 120 warrior, that is grit, resilience, and perseverance. You're hired. No, did not happen that way. Being proficient and excellent, achieving things that utterly don't hold weight, useless. We don't want to mislive, do we, right? All of us want to live well. Far beyond from just abstaining from triviality, we want, in a bit of a dated language, to hit the mark of God. We want to hit the mark. We want to hit the call of God. We want to hear the words at the end of the age, well done, good and faithful servant. We want the words spoken about us at the end of our life to be words of contribution, to be words of impact, to be words of love, to be words of generosity, to be words of kindness, that in some way in our short time on earth, we had represented and expressed the kingdom of God well. We want to live well. Think of the eulogy exercise you do in leadership trainings, right? You know, you write a eulogy of stuff you've accomplished, and you write the second eulogy of stuff that you dream and you want to accomplish, and you see the contrast between the two. Now, my suspicion for many of us, you know, in this vein of misliving, of pursuing God's call, living well, is that for many of us, it isn't distraction or the cares of the world that leads us into misliving. But for many of us, what causes us to settle for a mediocre life, void of the calling, the purpose, the destiny of God, is a sense of fear, disappointment, letdown, disillusionment that comes from a prolonged season of waiting, of hoping, of having our dreams deferred. Now, coming back again to Gangster's Paradise. In contrast to Coolio's version of Psalm 23, the Bible tells us this, that even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me, your rod and your staff, they comfort me. We read of the psalm and read on further, read of the assurance of God's nearness and presence in our valleys. And further down the psalm, we read of promises of victory on the other side of struggle. This is God's word. This is our hope. Now, as we conclude this teaching series that many of you know we put on the shelf at the start of 2020 when the pandemic really hit, and now we're visiting back, and it almost feels, at least to me as a pastor and many of our leadership team, as the closing of one chapter and the opening of the next. It feels like a hinge kind of series as we look forward to the future. I'd like to give us a word this day. And I titled my message, in line with the subject matter, but I also believe that this is a word from the Spirit for all of us. And this is my pastoral call and in some sense, a word of prophecy I like to give over our entire church. And that is this, that it is time to dream again. It is time to dream again. It is time to dream again. Let's pray as we begin this morning. I've already begun, but you're catching up. Let's pray. Jesus, we acknowledge your presence that's in this room. You who are Lord, you are here with us. Thank you for the promise of Scripture that tells us that when your people are gathered in your name, you are with them. So Jesus, we honor your presence here. We honor your Lordship. We honor that you draw near to us as we draw near to you. We honor that when we dive into your words, we find in Scripture today, we're not just diving into a kind of textbook, or reading and trying to make sense of it on our own, but your spirit is here in the room to illuminate these words, to bring them to life, but also to speak to our hearts, to move upon our hearts to respond well to your call to us. And Jesus, we thank you that you are the God of hope. You fill us with all joy and all peace in believing. So Jesus, we pray for where our hopes have been deferred and dashed. We look to you today as the source of hope, as the one who can bring our hopes to life again. We look not to secular humanism, we look not to self-help techniques to fix ourselves, but we look to you today. We behold you, Jesus, in your beauty, in your wonder, in your awe, in your majesty. We say, come, transform us, come meet us, come have your way in this place. We honor you, in your name. Amen. When I was 16, I came to faith in a hospital room. Many of you know the story. And after I prayed, you know, what was a sloppy version of a sinner's prayer, I prayed a secondary prayer and I said to Jesus, one day I will work for you. One day I'll work for you. You know, I had been so grateful that Jesus would save me, and the only kind of fitting response I knew to give in that moment was to offer not just my life. Well, my life is very important, but also my career, what I wanted to do in my future. I wanted to give it all to you, Jesus. And I knew from a young age that one day I'll end up in ministry. And you know, I'm a planner by nature and by disposition, and I plan to go into ministry somewhere in my 40s, when I'm really old, and when I'm mature, and I'm not that far from 40s where I mean, okay. This is how you lose a crowd, ladies and gentlemen. This is how you lose a crowd. When I'm mature and seasoned and have all my insecurities fixed at 40, I plan to go to ministry around then, right? And so in between, I had like all these things I wanted to do, all these stuff I wanted to accomplish. And at a point in time, you know, I had already gotten placed in uni, I knew I was in study, I knew all the things I wanted to do. And that was, my life was set. I had a trajectory, I knew where I wanted to go, what I wanted to do. And you know, the long and short of it, you know, is I was on vacation with my family, and after I was done reading a Christian book, you know, I had an encounter with Jesus. I saw this entire timeline that I had, you know, devised for myself. I saw where I was, I saw all the things I wanted to accomplish in between, and I saw ministry at the end, and I saw everything in the middle just disappear. And I saw the two come together, and then I knew that God had called me to go into ministry at a young age. You know, it wasn't my preference, it wasn't what I had planned, but I felt a calling. I had a vision and I wanted to respond to it well. And I sat down with my parents, you know, who are loving, pragmatic Asian parents who want the best for our children and want us, you know, to succeed in life. And I remember pitching to them this idea of ministry school, and of course them not having any idea or concept of what a ministry school is. And at the end of the conversation, you know, I at a point in time presented an Excel spreadsheet to my parents because I'm phenomenal that way. And so my dad told me to put close the spreadsheet lah. And then he asked me a series of questions about the school, about what it was about, what I could do after I was done, blah, blah, blah. And then he asked me this question at the end, and he said this, Andre, is this your dream? Is this your dream? And of course, you know, at that point in time, I was really, you know, taken aback by the language. You know, is this your dream? And I respond almost immediately and said, yes, this is my dream. And he said, okay. If this is your dream, then we'll do whatever is possible and whatever is in our power to make sure you live this dream. It's my dream to be in full-time ministry. It's my dream to follow Jesus. It's my dream to work in the church. Now, as long as God has been in relationship with people, He's been giving them dreams. He's been giving them dreams. And all through Scripture, we see God speaking to His people through dreams, planting in them a kind of seed, right, that will mature, that will grow, that will form them into their destiny, that they will find their part in God's story. God's people have always been dreamers. Now, there are 21 literal dreams that God gives to specific people in the Bible that instructs them to do something. Now, when I use the word dreams, and when I say the word dreams today, I don't mean just literal dreams when you sleep. But there are some people in our community who dream a lot and who have these prophetic dreams that are full of detail, full of story, full of meaning. I wake up in the morning and I don't remember anything. I never, ever dream. And so I've always wondered, like, is there something wrong with me? And so I don't have, like, those kind of dreams. I wonder how many of you fall in my kind of category. You just knock out. And then you wake up and you're still tired and want to sleep some more. I never dream. But when I talk about dreams today, I don't just mean like literal dreams. I mean dreams in the metaphoric sense, the broader metaphoric sense. This dream could be a vision that you carry in your heart, in your mind about a desired future. Could be a prophetic word that you've received about the role you are to play in God's family, in our world, in God's plan for flourishing. Could be a gut sense that God wants to do something in you or through you in the coming season. It could be a vague feeling of destiny, of calling in God's world. Maybe I was put on earth to do this, that kind of dream. Maybe your dream is about your career, your job, your business, the church, community, your family. Maybe it's a call to justice and mercy and mission. Maybe it's about the kind of man or woman God is making you to be. It could be about the impact or legacy you are to leave on the earth. A dream. My guess is each and every single one of you have some kind of dream deep in your heart. Maybe not just one, but two or three, or in PD's case, 50. You have a dream. Dreams. And I'll venture to say, and I'm a bit bold in saying this, that I'll venture to say that some of those dreams could be from the Spirit of God. John C. Maxwell, in his book on dreams, he wrote a book on dreams. He offers us a list of what he calls foolish dreams. Daydreams, distractions of the current world, pie in the sky dreams, wild ideas with no strategy or isn't grounded in reality, bad dreams, idealistic dreams, vicarious dreams, romantic dreams, career dreams, material dreams. But then, over and above all these things, there are God dreams. God dreams. It's where the Creator steps into creation and offers His people a vision for their lives or for how they are to live well, a vision for the role they are to play in joining Him in bringing about His kingdom. Dreams, they do play a key role in our lives. They function as a kind of roadmap for how we are to live. Without dreams, we wander around in circles. We get sucked into the tyranny of the urgent, always reacting to whatever is happening in the present, never envisioning of what is possible in the future. Helen Keller is the first person without sight or hearing to earn a bachelor's degree. She was once asked, you know, this really insensitive question: what's worse than being blind? She answered this: the only thing worse than being blind is having sight but no vision. Proverbs 29:18, we know this text really well. It talks about how those who lack vision or revelation, or prophetic vision, will cast off restraint. But this is in a message transliteration. It says this: if people can't see what God is doing, they stumble all over themselves. But when they attend to what He reveals, they are most blessed. And isn't that a phrase to sum up what this past couple of years has been? People stumbling over themselves, lacking vision, caught up in the tyranny of the urgent, always reacting to what is in front of them, never envisioning of what is possible in the future. Folks, we need a vision of our future destiny in God's story. I don't mean destiny in like the prosperity gospel sense or the health and wealth sense, but in biblical sense, our calling from God. We need to have a vision for that. We need to have a vision for the part we are to play in God's story. We need to have a vision for the gift that we are to offer to the world. We need to have a vision for our contribution to God's vision and plan to make all things new, all things right. We need a vision of future destiny. And so with that, we look at our first text in Genesis chapter 1. I want to give you a biblical theology of dreams, walk through a story, and then we'll land the plane maybe 1159. Genesis chapter 1. This is an opening page of scripture. Join me in reading God's word. So it says this: so God created mankind in his own image. In the image of God, he created them. Male and female, he created them. God blessed them and said to them, be fruitful and increase in number. Fill the earth and subdue it. Rule over the fish in the sea and the birds in the sky and over every living creature that moves on the ground. So here we see in the opening pages of scripture that humanity was created to rule. They were created to rule. Now the word rule, it seems so strong, right? It doesn't sit well in our culture because there's this idea of like dominating, right? And we see, you know, people in rule, people who have power using it as a way to oppress or destroy or to press down. But undoubtedly, scripture has said this, that we are called to rule. The word for rule that's used here is the Hebrew word radar. And one Hebrew scholar describes it as this way: it is to actively partner with God in taking the world forward. What a vision. What a vision. It can be translated to rule, to reign, or to have dominion. It's the language of royalty, right? It is what kings and queens do. They rule. They take the world forward. Now the phrase image of God in context of the ancient Near East was used specifically for royalty, right? Kings were thought to be, you know, divine beings, divine people, and they acted as a kind of mediator between God and the rest of humanity. And so we would say, or people would say then, that the king is the image of God. But by extension, it is to say that the rest of the people aren't the image of God. Only those who are royalty, only those who are ruling, they are the image of God. The rest of us aren't the image of God. And so set against that kind of backdrop, the Genesis story is entirely subversive because it says that we are all the image of God. It isn't just people who rule as royalty, isn't just a specific gender, isn't just a specific ethnic group, but we are all the image of God. We are made to rule on earth on God's behalf. Another text in Genesis chapter 2, verse 15 says this: the Lord God took the man and put him in the Garden of Eden to work it and take care of it. The word work it in Hebrew is a word abad, and it literally means to cultivate, develop, or draw out its potential. Beautiful words. And to take care of it is the word shema, which means to guard, to watch over, or to protect. So we are called to rule, we are called to work, to draw out potential from the earth, to cultivate, to develop it, to build. And we are also called to shema, to guard, to watch over, to protect. These words, to rule, to watch over, to work it, to take care of it. All scholars would sum all these words up into a singular word, and that word is vocatio. And it's where we get the word vocation from, and it would simply mean calling. Calling. Talk about calling, that's what we're called to rule, to work, to take care of God's earth. Now, the word calling is a really difficult thing to understand because of how liberally it's used in certain circles. So when I talk about calling, I want to frame it for you. I want to talk about calling in three sense or in three layers. The first is this: we are called to follow Jesus. That is, you know, the first and foremost calling. That is what we are called to do. You know, for some of us, when we think of calling, we think of it in relation to our career, right? We think of the Venn diagram, right? You know, my skills, my opportunities, and what I like. And we find a middle. That is my calling. But for most Christians of the world, in the world who literally live hand to mouth, that is not what they think of when they think about calling. We have privilege here in First Hope Singapore to think of calling in that sense, with what we prefer, what we would like to do, what is comfortable for us. But for the majority of Christians who follow Jesus faithfully in the world, that is not what calling is. Calling simply to them is following Jesus well, regardless of whatever context they're in. Amen? And so we have this first calling, to follow Jesus. The second thing is this: we are called to do our work as an act of discipleship. As an act of discipleship. Work occupies something like 2/3 of our life. It's where we spend the most of our time. And I argue to say that the primary context of our spiritual formation, of our transformation in God, is in our workplaces. We often don't think of work as an act of discipleship. We think of discipleship in the vein of what we do in church or the spiritual practices. But whether we, but in the context of our work, you know, whether it be how we respond to our bosses or co-workers, to being faithful in the mundane, to being excellent in what we produce, to resisting the allure of money, sex, and power, our workplaces, where we spend the bulk of our lives, aside from sleeping, is where God will form us. It's the primary context of spiritual formation. And the last thing we're called to do as God's creation, as the image of God in our world, is this. We are called to dream with God for our role in the flourishing of humanity. Now, I want you to notice this. The story of God doesn't end with the redemption of souls. As glorious as that is, God has promised to renew the whole world. Pastor Janice talked about it. The Bible gives us a peek into this glorious future, right? It starts with Jesus, follows up by the church. It picks up speed all the way to the book of Revelation. The restoration of all things will happen. Revelation chapter 21 says this, "Then I saw a new heaven and new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away. There was no longer any sea. I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride, beautifully dressed for a husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, 'Look, God's dwelling place is now among the people, and he will dwell with them. They will be his people, and God himself will be with them and be their God. He will wipe away every tear from the eyes. There will be no more death, or mourning, or crying, or pain, for the old order of things has passed away.'" This is the basis of Christian hope, folks. If our Christian hope that isn't eschatological isn't Christian hope at all. It's not just about hope, you know, in terms of like optimism or wishful thinking, but our hope is anchored in the person of Jesus, but also in the promises of Jesus. And he says this, that I will come to make all things new, all things right. But we notice that the story of the Bible doesn't end with all of us in heaven singing Amazing Grace 24/7. The story ends with a garden-like city here on earth where human beings would rule and reign with Christ. What we previously thought of as life after death, you know, by way of like enjoying mansions in heaven for above ground swimming pool. The Bible says that the biblical vision for how we are to live life after death is that we will rule and reign with Christ. His kingdom will be fully realized on the earth. Richard Mao would say this, the Christian life is directed toward a city, a place in which God's redemptive purposes for his creation will be realized. We think of the future life as a disembodied existence in an eternal realm, which is not our ultimate goal. Then it's difficult to think of our present cultural affairs as in any sense having a positive preparation for heavenly existence. But if we think of the future life in terms of inhabiting a heavenly city, we have grounds for looking for some patterns of continuity between our present lives as people immersed in cultural context and the life to come. Well, of course, God could make all things right himself. He chooses largely to work in relationship with us. He will give us his vision for this future city. He will put dreams and desires in our heart. And then he will invite us to work with him, to rule, to work it, to take care of it. This is what was lost in the fall. And now through Jesus Christ, through his atoning sacrifice at the cross, we have been grafted back into the story to work it, to take care of it, to rule. In summary, God entrusts this vision or dream of the flourishing of the world to mankind, to humanity, and invites them to co-labor with him to bring it about. So dreams, this vision that we receive from God, this desire that emerges from our heart, that we were made for so much more than just survival, are central to how God leads and guides us into our calling and destiny, into becoming who God made us to be and doing what God made us to do. Culture would say, you are what you do, but the Bible would say, you do what you are. And God has called us to be his images in our world. Now, when I talk about dreams, it's a tricky thing, isn't it, right? Because we realize that when God gives us a dream, or when God gives us a vision, when God gives us a prophetic word, there's often a gap between the conception of a dream and the actual fulfillment of a dream. It could be a gap of time. It could be a gap of circumstances, that in between, you know, where we are with the dream, receiving it and walking to it, there's this cold, hard reality called life. Or it could be a gap of capacity or character, right? Should the dream miraculously be fulfilled in your life there and then, you may not have the character to hold up, to stand, or to steward it with poise and humility and wisdom. We all would enter into this gap between the conception of a dream, the actual fulfillment of it. And that gap is hard. It's a long season of waiting for many. When we experience that gap, you know, we enter into this full emotional gamut of hope and then hopelessness, anticipation and faith, patience, confusion, doubt, impatience. And it's into this, you know, this call to dream and this call to dream well, but yet to live well in the gap between the conception of dream and the fulfillment of the promise, that we glean from the story of Joseph that we just heard at the start of the message. Now, we don't have time to go through this entire story, because it will take us till 2 p.m. But I'm sure many of you are familiar with the story. If not, you know, just look it up in the book of Genesis, starting in verse in chapter 37. Joseph's story, I like to put it to you, gives us this kind of roadmap, gives us a paradigm for how we are to live well in this gap, how we are to carry and steward our dreams well. We start off in Genesis chapter 37, verse 19, 20. This is following the story that we read earlier. It says this: they, meaning Joseph's brother, see him coming in the distance and say, "Here comes the dreamer." They said to each other, "Come now, let's kill him and throw him into one of the cisterns," and say that a ferocious animal devoured him. Then we'll see what comes of his dreams. And so we read earlier that Joseph has these two dreams, and these two dreams really offended and really, you know, confronted his brothers and his father and his mother, and you know, he's in this kind of flux. Now often I realize with dreams, they often go in a different way or in different path than what we would imagine to be. We started with Joseph's teenage dream, right? A vision of him leading his family, the sun and moon, which are representative of his father and mother, bowing to him. And, you know, it's either he's arrogant or completely oblivious, right? He shares, you know, this grandeur vision with his brothers, you know, this grand vision, which is not the best way to win over your older brothers. Imagine I would give a dream to you and say, "I see you bowing down before me." Probably won't go well, right? You see, you know, no doubt, you know, Joseph's ego and pride and arrogance at play. And then we read this story in Genesis chapter 37, where his brothers would ambush him. They'll strip him of his father's robe, and they'll throw him in an underground cistern, planning to murder him or at least have an animal consume him. And however, later in the story, we read that instead of killing him, they thought of this alternative of selling him, because at least we can make some money off the guy. And so Joseph was sold to slave traders, and they made some money off his demise. And I would like you to just notice this point. Joseph's, you know, dream or the vision that he had was that he would rule, he would reign, and he would have all these people bow before him. But notice the story. In this story, what happens? Instead of having people bow to him, instead of ruling, Joseph was now being sold into slavery. Instead of having his brothers bow to him, he now had to bow to his slave masters. Instead of ruling and reigning, he was now a slave. Now, has that ever happened to you? You had a dream, you had a vision, you had a prophetic word, you have this sense that God wants to do this kind of thing with you. And the next thing that happens is that it goes in an utterly different direction. Dreams often turn out different. Second thing that dreams often, the path that dreams often go is that it often becomes harder than we think we could bear, harder than we would imagine it to be. In Genesis chapter 39, verses 2 and 4, it says this: the Lord was with Joseph, so that he prospered and he lived in the house of his Egyptian master. When his master saw that the Lord was with him and that the Lord gave him success in everything he did, Joseph found favor in his eyes and became his attendant. Potiphar put him in charge of his household, and he entrusted to his care everything he owned. So as the story unfolds, I know I'm skipping a couple chapters, we see God's hand on Joseph's life, right? Things seem to be on the up and up, right? Joseph was now finding favor in Potiphar's house. He was made ruler over the entire household. It looked like he was on the upward trajectory. Finally, things were taking shape. It was smooth sailing from here on in. Things were going well. Things were going good. And then tragedy strikes. We know the story, right? Potiphar's wife accuses him of sexual assault, impropriety, and then he's thrown into prison. And he remains there for a long time. Now, often when we carry a dream, we often are prone to romanticizing it, right? It's this perfect, ideal future, right? I have a dream and it's going to pan out, it's going to turn out this way, it's going to be beautiful, it's going to be perfect. And I believe that Joseph had those kinds of illusions. He thought that he was going to be a ruler the next day. And when we carry a dream or a vision, we often think that it'll go that way. It won't be hard, it'll be easy, it'll be smooth. After all, it came from God. Now, marriage is a great example of this. Paul in 1 Corinthians 7 says this, "Those who marry will face many troubles in life." We should put that verse on in the front page of our premarital course. Right. It's in the Bible. I did not make it up. Right. You know, I suspect one of the driving forces behind, you know, many of the breakdowns in marriages, the divorces we see in our culture, is that people go into their marriages with stars in their eyes, with this idealized future, with this idealized or illusions about this person they're entering the marriage with, right? They don't so much fall in love with a person, they fall in love with an idea of that person. And when that person doesn't match up to the idea, day upon day upon day, they get disillusioned. And then they step out. This romanticized, idealized interpretation of a person. Marriage is a very good thing, folks. But it's not all bliss. It's often harder than people imagine. Now, coming back to my dream, you know, I had this dream of being in full-time ministry. And I went through 3 years of ministry school. And I came back and I started working on staff on the 1st of July. My birthday is on the 2nd of July. Not that any of you remember, but my birthday is on the 2nd of July. So 1st of July, I came on staff. I started working and, you know, call me young, call me naive, call me having this, you know, like illusions about what working life is and what ministry is. I had all these ideals and illusions of what ministry would be. I entered into work my first day, and the second day on my birthday, I had drafted my resignation letter. I was ready to go out and out. No offense, PD, but that was what happened, you know. I had this romanticized idea of what ministry would be, and it got really hard. It got harder than I expected it to be. Different, harder. That's often the trajectory of dreams. We receive a dream from God. Turns out different than we thought. Becomes harder than we would like it to be. And often, folks, it takes longer than we like to wait. It takes longer. Different, harder, longer. There are chapters in the story of the life of Joseph, and he spends almost 2 decades. Joseph was 17 when he receives the dreams. He was 30 when he became ruler of Egypt, and 9 more years passed before his dream came to pass. And so if you do the math, this quick math, it adds up to 22 years between him receiving the dream and that dream actually being fulfilled. 22 years. 22 years. For many of us, when we read this story, it takes us all of 2 minutes. But this is 22 years of a guy's life. Now, I don't know about you, but when I receive a dream from God, I'm like, yes, let's go do this thing. Come on, quick. Let's expedite this thing. Let's have it tomorrow. But oftentimes, it takes longer than I'd like to wait. In the life of Joseph, it was 22 years. There's this really depressing line at the start of chapter 41. And it starts off this way, when 2 full years had passed. 2 full years have passed. Just this quick line that often we just read, like, okay, next line. 2 full years had passed. Can you imagine that? It's easy to just skip over, right? But this guy waited and waited and waited. And he didn't wait in the best of circumstance, right? He was sitting in prison. No word from God, all alone, no hope of release. Day after day, waiting and waiting and waiting. Different. Harder, longer. When we carry a dream for God, it's often different, or it pans out different than we would imagine it to be. It's often harder than we think or would like it to be. It often takes longer than we like to wait. But the good news is this, that it is often better than what we hope for, what we can hope for, conceive of, or imagine. Read down further in the story, Genesis chapter 45. Big text, and let's just read through this and we'll land the plane shortly. Starting verse 1, then Joseph could no longer control himself before all his attendants, and he cried out, "Have everyone leave my presence." So there was no one in Joseph when he made himself known to his brothers, and wept so loudly that the Egyptians heard him and Pharaoh's household heard about it. That's an interesting detail. Verse 3, Joseph said to his brothers, "I am Joseph." He revealed himself to them because they did not recognize him. And he had to say, "I am Joseph." And he asked, "Is my father still living?" But his brothers were not able to answer him because they were terrified at his presence. Verse 4, then Joseph said to his brothers, "Come close to me." When they had done so, he said, "I am your brother Joseph, the one you sold into Egypt. And now do not be distressed and do not be angry with yourselves for selling me here, because it was to save lives that God sent me ahead of you. For 2 years now, there has been famine in the land, and for the next 5 years, there will be no plowing and reaping. But God sent me ahead of you to preserve for you a remnant on earth and to save your lives by a great deliverance." So remember in chapter 37, right? Joseph has this dream, has this vision from God. And his initial interpretation was this. It's all about himself. Everyone's going to bow to me. It's about his glory, it's about his destiny, it's about his fulfillment. It's about his own kind of joy, his own kind of pleasure. This is all about me. God is going to do this for me. And then we read at the end that the dream wasn't really about Joseph at all. It was about saving the family of Israel. Joseph did get his glory eventually. His brothers did bow down, but it's after years of humiliation, pain, and loss. And God will strip Joseph of his ego and idolatry and arrogance and mature him into the kind of person who could steward the fulfillment of the dream. One of the most interesting details of the story is that Joseph's brothers did not recognize Joseph when they saw him. I choose to think that it wasn't that Joseph had aged like me and became old and they were like, "Oh, who's this really old guy? I do not recognize him." But I'll choose to believe that it was because of the work that God had done in him through that gap that they could no longer recognize him, that this egoistic, pompous, arrogant young boy had now matured into a person of love who could steward the fulfillment of the promise well. So in thinking of Joseph's story, I think of our dreams, you know, is in some sense going through, you know, the story of Jesus. There's often a birth of a dream, and then there's a death and burial of a dream. This feeling that it's all over, that hope has all been lost. But folks, the good news is this, that if the dream is from God, there is almost always certainly a resurrection. When it comes back to life, it's not the same, it's always better, better than what you can hope for, conceive, or imagine. Are you with me, folks? Now, shifting gears, you know, dreams, different, harder, longer, but better. You know, I mentioned at the start of the series that, you know, this teaching, you know, we are revisiting it, you know, after, you know, a prolonged period of walking through, you know, the pandemic as a church. And some of you have joined us in recent times, but for many of you, you are kind of like the people that have been around for a long time and have, you know, walked this journey with the church over the last few years. And so, you know, we kind of shut down that teaching because we thought, okay, you know, this teaching about community, about life together isn't really like appropriate in a time where we're all like socially isolated and distanced. And, you know, the pastoral team there, you know, we really felt this call and injunction to exalt you, the church. From this text in James chapter 1, "Let perseverance finish its work so that you may be mature and complete, not lacking anything." We are to hold fast. We are to persevere. We are to allow the trying times that we're living in then to form us into a people of love, to mature us. But even as we look ahead as a church, now I can't help but think of that line from Ecclesiastes where it talks about how everything has a season. And even though that pastoral call injunction is right and fitting, isn't the lifestyle that God has called us to live. Isn't a lifestyle that God has called us to live to just bunker down, wait it out, But God has called us to dream with him, to join him in hoping and envisioning him with him for a future that is bright, for a future that is glorious, for a future where his kingdom comes to earth in great power, in great measure. This is the life that God has called us to live as his image bearers, as his followers. You know, I've been seeing a counselor for some time, and you know, we talked through a bulk of my issues. We're talking about, you know, my life story and some of my struggles and what drives stress and anxiety in my life. And after many, many sessions with him, after hearing my story again and again and again, hearing of all the stuff that, you know, causes, you know, this deep unsettledness in my heart, he makes a very simple observation. He says this to me at one point. He says, "Andre, do you realize how much of a life is ruled by fear? Do you realize how much of a life is ruled by fear?" And we say that it's almost as though like scales fell off my eyes. I realized for the first time how fearful of a person I am. Fearful of everyone's opinion. Fearful of disappointing. Fearful of not being significant. Fear of the unknown. Fear of being caught off guard. Fear of not being prepared. And especially over the last couple of years, you know, this has been so true because I felt like my role as your pastor has shifted from envisioning and dreaming of the future to reacting well to the various measures that come week on week. Early on in the pandemic, we would get an MCCY you know, circular Friday evening, and we had to implement it by Sunday. And all through the last 2.5 years, it has been just, you know, with bated breath, waiting for new measures to come in, new circulars coming, new stuff that we got to implement in church. And much of the work that I had given myself to, and by extension our staff, the last 2.5 years is just reacting to the present. And what I've not realized, you know, up till recent times is that this muscles of faith, of hope, of dreaming had largely atrophied for me. I wonder if it's the same for you. And so, you know, my sense is for us as a church, landing this now, is that as we turn the page and look forward to a new chapter, it's a call to dream again. It's a call to dream again. To have new vision for the future of our lives, you know, as God's image bearers on the earth. But to have new vision for our future as a church community. To dream of the kind of church we can be in our world. To dream of the kind of followers we want to be in the midst of a culture. To dream of the kind of contribution we can offer our world as agents of God's blessing, shalom, and renewal. From Moses to his dream of the Exodus, from Paul to his dream of being an apostle to the Gentiles, from David to his dream of a temple, God's people has always been dreamers. They've always been people caught up in God's vision, not just caught up in the tyranny of the present and reacting to what's in front of them, but caught up in God's story and desire for his kingdom to come in power. Now think of that text in Acts chapter 2. It talks about Joel's prophecy, right? The last days God says, "I'll pour out my spirit on all people. Your sons and daughters will prophesy. Your young men will see visions. Your old men will dream dreams." And what is distinctive to this spirit-filled, spirit-empowered, spirit-possessed community is that they dreamed. They dreamed. So I'd love to leave this question with you. What about you? What about you? What about you? Do you need to start dreaming? Do you need to ask God for grace and for courage to open your heart and mind and life to what's possible through the Spirit? Do you need to plow through layers of grief, of cynicism, of compromise, of disappointment, of hopelessness, and unearth a dream that God has put inside of you? For some of you, God has put a dream inside of you in the days of your youth. And I see some of you receiving dreams, prophetic promises, calling from God as a young person. And as you went through university, you developed a career. Career is great. Career is beautiful. You're doing an amazing, amazing job, amazing thing on the earth. But that dream still lies within you. And so my invitation to all of us as we close this series, as we conclude this teaching on community, what does it mean to do life together well, is a call to dream again. To dream again. And folks, my injunction or my encouragement to you today is this: when the dream comes out different than we would like it to be, stop grasping. Let it be. When it's harder than you'd like it to be, don't give up. Persevere to the end. When it's longer than you would hope for, imitate those who through faith and patience inherited the promises of God. And when it's better than you can hope for, conceive of, or imagine, praise God and weep with joy, for God is with you. Amen. Can we all stand? How are you all doing? Good? You know, we have an installation outside that has different ways for you to interact with it. But, you know, as Pastor Janice said, you know, our heart is to have our entire community contribute to a vision for a church for our future. You know, one of the earlier kind of pictures I had as we were praying into a potential move for our church and as we were praying into what was next for our church, is that I had this vision of this large canvas that spanned the entire foyer, and all of us are walking up to this blank canvas and throwing paint on it. And that's all of us throwing, you know, unique colors of paint that we all carried onto the canvas. And out from that exercise, you know, came forth this beautiful city skyline that was multicolored, that looked absolutely beautiful. And then God spoke to me that the vision of church is not to be carried by one, two individuals, but we are to all contribute and carry the vision together. And so this is not just a feel-good exercise, but I believe this is prophetic. I believe this is what God has called us to do in this next chapter of church. We are to dream together for our community, folks. And as your pastor, I want to say this. I need your dreams. I need you to pray into this. I need you to contribute. You know, I have dreams for our church. You know, I put up a slide, but I have no time to go through this. I have dreams for our facility, for it to be high in functionality, but also transcendent. I believe in the beauty of creativity, of art. I have dreams for community that have space to cater to crowds, but also spaces for silence, for prayer, for solitude. I have dreams for a community to be used for Sunday services, but also above that as a primary kind of objective and a primary kind of trust to see it being used for mission all through the week. I have dreams of it being a school of formation. I have dreams of it being a house of prayer. I have dreams of it being a hub for hospitality and mission. And so what dreams do you carry for a community? What dreams are upon your heart? I invite you to go to the foyer and write them down, draw them out, do whatever you will. Now in closing, as I mentioned, you know, when we carry a dream from God, we often go through, you know, the story of Jesus or the story of Jesus or the key moments in Jesus' life. Often, you know, we walk through that same kind of story of our dreams. There's often a birth of a dream, a death and burial of a dream. But praise God, there is resurrection on the other side. So I'd love to pray for you this day, you know, as you contemplate over the last 2.5 years, what dreams lie dormant, what dreams have gone to die, what hope has fizzled out. And praise God, He is alive and seated on the right hand of the Father. Praise God that Jesus did not stay in the grave, but He rose on the third. Praise God that Jesus is alive and well, and Jesus is here among us to bring forth His resurrection life. Praise God that we are a people of the resurrection. Praise God that all things are possible through Him. Praise God that God gives us dreams and invites us to partner with Him. Praise God that God gives us a purpose, a calling, and a destiny. Praise God that God has put us here on earth for a purpose, and we get to join Him and co-labor with Him and see the renewal of our world. Praise God, for He has given us this through His Son. And so with your eyes closed and your head bowed in this place, let's in a moment of reflection come before God and say, God, where there has been hope lost, won't you renew it again? Where dreams have gone to die and are forgotten and forsaken and put on a shelf, bring them to the fore once again. Where there is death, let there be life. Thank you, Jesus. God, I pray in your name that there will be a resurrection of dreams in this place. Resurrection power to invade every life in this place, bring forth dreams and desires that have been put aside due to fear and disappointment. God, may we join in your story with courage and confidence this day. With courage and confidence this day. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, God. In your own way, begin to lift your hands and with hands open, with heart surrender, say, God, won't you meet me here again? Renew me, restore me. Where hope has been lost, where dreams have been put aside, renew them, oh God. Thank you, God, for your life. Thank you, God, for your resurrection. Thank you, God, for your power. Give us the endurance to run this race well. And give us courage to believe, faith to act, faith to live this out, God. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. Let's go back in the song together.